offense to your profession or mine or whatever, but you see a number of coaches and a number of nutritionists who really look like they got into it because they were weak in it and are still, you know, still bad doing that battle. I feel like that a little bit as a coach athlete still, that am I really in the shape I should be in to do this? But right. You are. So congratulations on that.
I'm trying. I'm trying to fight the clock, but yeah.
Right. Well, for me, it's the busyness and trying to sit here and do magazines and that kind of thing and still get out there and exercise.
Right.
I get to get in the water and teach sometimes now. And yesterday I had to actually demonstrate to some swimmers, we have this pulley thing that they couldn't get across the pool. And I had to jump in and show them that it can be done.
Good for you. That's awesome.
Am I going to die doing this? But the thing, you know, I was thinking about with Ron Aiken, and I was, because we know we're trying to write this software, and then we're working with Dr. G, who already has software. Mm-hmm. But none of it includes nutrition, you know, and so we on the one side, Ron's really strong in that his swimmers never swim a lap. He's called, you know, garbage yardage by the people that are just the sprint people. Yeah. And just the, you know, always have to go race pace. And you can agree or disagree with that. But on the other hand, you know, he never goes garbage yardage. He always knows the stroke count. So the kids at any time will tell him, you know, I just took 24 strokes for the last 50 meters or whatever it is. Mm-hmm. So there's that. And then that's being, you know, obviously connected to stroke work, connected to physiology. Mm-hmm. But what happens when you're running out of gas, or what happens when you've got too much gas because of something you ate yesterday or whatever, you know, any way you want to put it. And you gotta look at that. I mean, if you're racing the Indy 500, it's really, really important that you manage your fuel or you mm-hmm. lose the race. Now, you know, there are some races when maybe that's not quite as true when it's shorter, but I think it's always true because, and here's the point, and then I'll let you kind of put in how you think this ought to work. Yeah. Is that even if you didn't need a lot of energy to swim a given race, like the 50, you know, mm-hmm. you see people swim the 50 and they break every rule of training, you know, it looks like, but then you see the very best of the best. And yes, that day, they don't need a lot of fuel to get across the pool. You can look at that in a lot of different ways, but they don't need a lot in terms of what somebody might need for the mile or for the things you do with triathlon.
Right.
But they needed it day by day by day by day in order to build up to the place where they have the musculature, the, you know, and be able to do tomorrow what you did today, or at least some part of it, what you did today, to build on that over the course of a week or a lifetime, macro cycle, micro cycle, whatever, right? Mm-hmm. So how do we build that? And here's my question, and maybe it's rhetorical, but as we build this right now, we're building it with an Excel framework, and you say, okay, you're going to go 50K on this week of this cycle. Mm-hmm. It's going to be EN1 mostly, and then EN2 and whatever else we decide to do. Mm-hmm. What are the energy requirements, and are you meeting those requirements? So we know whether or not the person is meeting the requirement of being able to go hundreds on 120, averaging 110, where mm-hmm. 2 weeks ago you averaged 111, let's just say. Mm-hmm. That might mean, it can mean a lot of things, but it might mean you're at least managing energy more effectively. Maybe you're faster. Maybe you fixed a stroke problem. Maybe your turns are better. Maybe you're breathing a little bit differently. But in general, overall, your performance potentially could be better because you've made that shift of the line of best fit.
Yep.
But what if you could have done it better if your nutrition were better? You know, and we know this about cars. We know if the octane levels are different. You know, we know if you use airplane fuel, it can work for some cars and they're designed for it. Other cars, you know, the funny cars maybe need a certain kind of fuel, and the Indy 500 cars or the, you know, Grand Prix cars need a different kind of fuel.
Right.
And then there's maybe one more thing, and you can just talk to this, is, you know, maybe there's too much fuel, and when do you fuel?
Timing.
So how do we build this into software? How do we build it into the algorithm?
Yeah. Yeah. That part's difficult, I think, because we're humans, you know, we're not machines. So we're all going to metabolize nutrients differently. So I don't know if an algorithm would be able to calculate that across all swimmers.
Sure.
I think it's so individual. I think you could probably come up with a general algorithm and then individualize that further down when you're working with individual athletes. But I think the broader picture is just to know and understand and have athletes and coaches understand that it's a big piece of the puzzle. So like you said, we're working so much on stroke count and technique and breathing and body position in the water, but are we really focusing on what they're eating beforehand? Not even right beforehand, but consistently in the days and weeks, because we're training so much. As an athlete, you're always either preparing for a training session or recovering from one, because athletes are working out so much. You know, swimmers are working out twice a day, most of them, and they're lifting and they're stretching and they're doing all these other things. So they have a very high cell turnover. So in order for those cells to turn over and be more efficient and stronger and faster and metabolize nutrients better, there needs to be the nutrient foundation there for those cells to turn over. If it's not there, if we're eating cookies and pizza every day, those cells are not going to turn over to the capacity that they could if they had all the vitamins and minerals and protein and omega-3s and everything that they really need to turn over to be the best athlete that that athlete can be. That's the big picture. Mm-hmm. How you measure that gets very tricky, because of individual metabolic rates and genetics and everything else that goes into it. And nutrition and metabolism is also differs depending on intensity, duration, and speed of, and frequency of training. So if you have an athlete that's training twice a day, it's going to be a different nutrient recommendation than an athlete that's training once a day.
Obviously, there's other variables like, you know, stress and, you know, are they going to school? Do they have a tough job? They have, you know, sleep. Are they trying to make a living, sleep, all yep. those things. But I think in a sense, it's not a cop-out. I don't think either one of us are copping out on this. We're actually, I think, you know, this is sort of a brainstorming session too. Yeah. We have those same individualization problems. They say problems, yeah. but they're fun. They're fun in a sense. In yeah. a sense, this is why smart people do what we do, because, you know, anybody can write a workout, 10 100s on 120, and then, you know, you're just descending sets or whatever, and they just write it.
Right.
But there's other people that really try to write it and design it in a way that, as you say, adapts to the individual needs and velocity shifts of mm-hmm. that person. And right. and I think that's what Ron and I are trying to do. It's also what we're trying to do is, in a sense, when he came to me, he said, this is really wise, I think, of him. He said, you know, this is really working for my 12 athletes. You know, mm-hmm. we're really doing well. The sun's shining on us. They seem to be the right 12 and all that stuff. And we yeah. talk about the psychology of it and even the sociology of pitting those people together and pitting them against each other every day. And he's mm-hmm. really got it sort of made. But I think his point was, how do I do this for my other 400 swimmers? How do we do it? And then for me, how do we do it across the board? How do we know? And I don't mean necessarily, but we always have this problem. As we'll say is, I have a stroke that I want for a height, and I really individualize for the height, arm length, hand size, and stuff like that as a biomechanist for a swimmer. We want almost all swimmers to be able to keep that elbow by their eye before it gets past them, so they get a big paddle. But there mm-hmm. are people that we have that either don't have the flexibility or the strength, or they maybe even have shoulder problems where they're better off with a straighter pulling with the lats and making mm-hmm. some changes. There's people that have differences in their rhythm. Maybe they're much stronger on one side than the other, and they always maybe will be. Maybe they can kick and have really flexible ankles, others don't. So we're constantly adapting anyway. Yeah. To that. And then physiologically, yeah, some people just have more fast twitch muscle fibers. Some have more slow twitch. Some can cross over. Mm-hmm. Some can, you know, some are pretty obvious, like Michael Andrew coming back in 30 point in the 200 IM, you know, there's a training problem there. And that's pretty obvious. And it's pretty easy to fix from my standpoint, it's pretty easy to fix. We just have to philosophically, you know, adapt him a little bit more, I think. Now, he may think the opposite of me, but at some point, it's measurable. And that's what I love about what we're talking about here. Nutrition actually is measurable by the individual. If you keep going, if you keep testing to see what's working, right? So yeah, you could say it's sleep, but if sleep is, if we can make a constant of most of the other things and then shift things in nutrition, we might well be able to find really cool answers for each individual. But as you said, not all individuals are going to have the same answer. There's certain foundational things. I think we talked about last time, but we probably ought to bring up again, is that everyone needs a certain amount of calories based upon just a general amount of metabolism. But some people metabolize much faster. Some people are hyper all the time, like me. Some people are really slow all the time and just relaxed all the time. And they have different needs. But in general, you could say for a person's given weight that there's a range of nutrition that they need in terms of just calories to survive, probably a certain amount of vitamin C, A, for a, right?
There are general guidelines like that for sure. And there are for non-athletes, and then there's guidelines for athletes, which is interesting. But then underneath that, you have to account for different metabolic rates, and you can get athletes in a lab and test their metabolic rates and really get it down to, you know, a smaller range of caloric needs. And then this is what I do when I work individually with athletes, is really break it down further into, okay, you're a sprinter, so you need XYZ to get through your A race, or you're a distance swimmer, so now you need this, which is a whole different set of nutrients to look at, and a timing aspect to look at, just based on what their A races are.
Right. So like creatine needs might be higher, for just example that I can just think of off the top of my head, for a sprinter, somebody that's really a power sort of athlete that needs a better jump off the block, that needs, you know, more power off the turns, and that needs to be able to turn over faster and can. And that's the other thing too, is you put all the creatine you want into a Kenyan marathoner, but they're probably not going to be using it very much, or maybe it's even sort of irrelevant. It might even make them kind of nauseous or whatever. And that's the other thing, is individuals are going to give us that feedback of, well, this, you know, this might work for somebody, but for a long time with triathlons, I couldn't figure out what to eat because I was getting nauseous no matter what I ate. You know, but I had to eat, I just couldn't figure it out. And so that's part of your thing with individualizing, right? But in general, I mean, I think if we just said, okay, let's build the algorithm. So what we're saying is, you know, what Ron basically says is, okay, on this week, over the course of an 18-month plan, which he does really well with, you know, I've gotten some of that from, I think he doesn't even know he got it from Tudor Bompa, but in the periodization of training sort of stuff, where he does a really good job of periodizing, we're going to go 50K, you look at that, or you build it into the Excel algorithm and go, okay, when they're going 50K versus they come in, let's say they come in September, let's say they're going 20K a week, right? And then as it comes up, it's just the algorithm just immediately says, okay, you need more of this. We might even get so, I don't know if this is personally specific, but if you're a female versus a male, and we know you put in your cycle and you say, okay, at this week, typically per month, you know, we're going to eat a little bit more of this, you know, we're going to have a little more iron. We're going to, you know, maybe you're going to eat more meat. Maybe you don't eat that much meat, but maybe in this week you'll eat another day of meat or whatever.
Right. So more carbs at different times in your cycle. Yeah. That's a great point too.
Yeah. And of course, obviously taper, you know, maybe a little less calories, but a little, maybe making up for whatever was missing in the, and maybe back to your point about last time you made about getting blood tests. If you're really super serious, find out. Yeah.
Yeah. Just what your deficiencies are, because there's really no need to supplement if you're not deficient.
Yeah.
But once you find a deficiency, then you know what you need to supplement with.
Yeah. So you think this is possible within some range of algorithm without going into it? I mean, in a sense, we have a lab, right?
Yeah.
The good thing about swimming is, you know, the velocity, if you're a good coach, you know, the velocity, that they're going, you know, and typically, and you even planned it maybe again with what percentage of your best time that you're going. And we know that there's more energetics in that, that there's an energy need and difference in that. I wonder if we can get close within, you know, within, obviously it's not completely scientific. You're not factoring for every possible, you know, you're not just having one thing to measure, right?
Right.
But within that, to know that within a range, that if you are within this calorically or minerals or vitamins, what else? Should there be a difference of with certain people of fats, protein, and whatever else? Can we do that?
Yeah, I mean, I think you hit the nail on the head when you said periodization, because your nutrition has to reflect your training. So we could do general recommendations based on the different phases of training that you're in. And that would be macronutrients, fat, carbs, and protein. And then a bigger aspect of that would be just caloric needs in general. And then under the umbrella of caloric needs would be macronutrients, fat, protein, and carbs. And then we could do general recommendations for micronutrients. So you have, you know, just a general recommendations for athletes. And then once athletes kind of put that into practice, then you can tweak it as it goes along based on their individual needs and what we learn about each of the athletes, such as micronutrient deficiencies or strength gains. Maybe certain athlete is struggling with power and strength. So maybe we need to play around with their protein intake a little bit and creatine supplementation possibly and give that 6 or 8 weeks to take and see if that works. I always call it a little bit of nutritional CSI. Like sometimes you just got to get in there and try things and see if it works. And then if it does, great. And if it doesn't, try something else. Because there are a number of different ways you can tweak nutrition to boost performance.
So yeah, in terms of that CSI, we should give you as many clues as possible, right? When we're writing this algorithm. So we say, okay, yeah, this person is now taking 12 strokes per lap. They used to take 13, and they're averaging that for an entire, you know, session. They're actually that much better. Mm-hmm. We'd like to get them to 11 or, you know, whatever. And part of that is their best 100 is a 53 for 100 meters. And that is world class. But what we're seeing is that their best event looks like it's the 4, mm-hmm, and they're not holding. They're holding 85% of their best 100. Mm-hmm. We'd like to nudge it to 86%, which, yep, is a pretty big difference in terms of when you're at that level trying to win, yeah, you know, against, you know, Ledecky or somebody, right, on a nutrition basis. What do you see, Jennifer? What do you think? What do you think we ought to try? Here's basically what they're eating in terms of calories. Mm-hmm. It's going to be maybe somewhat challenging to get them to give us everything, but if they're pretty regular, they probably are pretty regular. It's easy to say. In American swimming, it's really random. It's pretty much like the East Germans used to say when they were cheating, but their scientists came over one time. And the famous thing is they said, after visiting all these teams in America, they said, your training is like you put a bunch of eggs in a basket, you throw them against the wall, and whichever ones don't break, those are your athletes, right?
I love that.
I think we're still there. And but I think if people knew, it's kind of like what Dr. G says too, is fine, you know, you can randomly throw workouts out there. And then you go head to head with Mark at Mission when he was using him, and you go head to head with Ron in Las Vegas Sandpipers, and you find you can't finish with them. What is the thing? And what I look for is pretty much what I just said is, mm-hmm, yes, your swimmer is winning the 100, but they're really, really failing at the 2. Mm-hmm. Now, the 100 is more about, I think this is the way I put it, it's not true, but it's closer to true, I think, is God makes the sprinters and I build the rest. You know, it's like, it's not, yeah, exactly true, of course, because the rest also takes genetics.
Right.
And it also, and the 50 takes great, you know, coaching and training too.
Yeah.
But in a sense, it's kind of true is when we did this, I don't know if I told you this, but we did a worldwide study back in the 1990s. I got data from the international swimming statisticians And we ran, Nick Theory was great. He happened to have it in a spreadsheet that worked on Excel in a Mac. And he gave it to me, and I took it to my friend who's a PhD physicist who used to swim for me. And I said, can you run an algorithm that doubles the 50 and subtracts it from the 100 to show what we call the drop-off rate for everybody ranked in the top 100 in the world for each event? So we did it for the 50 to the 100, 100 to the 200, 200 to the 400 meters, and then et cetera. Right. And we found some great stuff. In fact, we found that the Chinese were cheating at the time.
No way.
Because there was no way they could be that much better than us unless they were just training so much better. And they did have the East German coaches, but they were also, it was just a hint because they were so far ahead of the Aussies and us. Mm-hmm. And we went, we know we train like crazy. We go a lot of mileage and we have this, but all of a sudden the Chinese came from here to boom. We went, okay, there's a billion something people. And then it came out they were actually cheating. And I went, we kind of knew.
Yeah. How are they cheating?
Well, they were drinking steroids. They're women.
They were okay.
Crazy. Okay. And they were finally busted. But not so funny thing was they were using the same East German coaches that were busted in East Germany and then couldn't coach there anymore. And of course, the breakdown and everything. And so, we knew before they knew. Now, here's what's cool is if we do this with nutrition, and it's the one other factor, like everything we're doing exactly the same. Ron keeps dominating pretty much everybody and whatever, Texas and et cetera. There are certain teams that are just, wow. They're able to hold way higher percentages based upon the talent that they get. Now they get great talent too.
Right.
But it's easy to say that. There are other factors, of course, like in the 50 to the 100, if you don't have very flexible ankles, but you can drive them to be flexible, you can only do that for the 50. Then I go after their ankle flexibility. So those have given me hints, and we'll be talking about that and might come to our thing. There's a Zoom that World Swimming Coach Association is doing with me in August, cool. August 25th. And great. I'm bringing in a physiologist too. And at the same time, we're going to show the specific exercises that I've designed or I've found or got on Craigslist or whatever to improve, for example, ankle flexibility and shoulder rotators and that kind of thing. And isokinetics and that kind of thing. But so we figured out some things with, as you said, CSI.
Yeah.
How do we do this with nutrition? Now, some things will be pretty obvious. If we get, let's say we get somebody that's really great in the 50 and falls apart, misses a lot of practices, gets sick all the time. And we get them to honestly tell us their diet is cold pizza, beer and whatever. That one will be pretty easy.
Yeah.
But I don't even know where to start. Maybe we can start with a team that's really, really buying into this. And do you have an idea or what do you think we ought to do?
It's funny because those cases that you just mentioned are easy as long as the swimmer is open to making changes, because a lot of this is behavioral change too and psychology. So if they're open to kind of giving up their cold pizza and beer because they want, and this is the greatest thing about athletes is most of them are super motivated to get better. So they will put that motivation towards their nutrition and then sky's the limit, right? But there are some athletes that are great and they're eating pizza and beer, whatever it is, and they don't feel the need to make that change because they're already great. But what they don't realize is that they do change their nutrition, they can be like much, much better. So they can be world-class that, some people are just okay with being great and they don't see that next level.
Right.
So it just depends on the psychology of the swimmer. I forgot your question.
The Hicks saying of you can't fix stupid. In a sense, it is sort of stupid. If you've said, look, I'm in the top five in the world and I keep taking fifth and I'm tired of taking fifth. And we say, you've done everything else. Mm-hmm. Let's keep doing those things that you're doing. And let's see if nutrition will make the difference. And here's the funny thing is nutrition will also make the difference in fixing stupid because they're not thinking that well when they don't have enough energy or when they're hyperactive because all they've had is coffee in the morning,
or they're not recovering well. Yeah.
Yeah, they're on fire. I think maybe it doesn't fix it for them, but here's the coolest thing about what I do is fine, you have your philosophy, you know, fine, just keep doing it, Michael. Just keep going, coming home in 30 point in the last 50. Just keep doing that. And then eventually, maybe you'll show up on, you know, you'll show back up on Greg's doorstep and say, okay, what did you do with Dressel? You know, and can I have a season with you to see whether or not your way might be better than the way that I've taken from this one doctor who has all kinds of ideas. And then maybe, you know, maybe you'll give me, I know he's done some training camps with them. So maybe they've learned something, I think, from how he sprints. And so that's all true too. But what if then we take this one last thing and we say, so that, and that's the case I would do with him. That would be my thing is, okay, great, Andrews, you come this far, but it's mostly DNA and God bless you. And God has blessed you, but you want that last 50 to be within 90% of your best 50. Then let's do it differently. But what if the problem was he did everything that way, but he's still second in the world. And what does he do now? And let's talk about nutrition. Now, in his case, maybe he's awesome with nutrition and he's got this other problem, but that's not your problem. your problem to solve is what do we do with somebody that is willing to and has done everything right and is willing to take a look at where they are in terms of their minerals, their calories, their balance of carbohydrates and fats and protein. When they eat, you gotta put it into sleep, but I think sleep is also affected by nutrition. Is that true?
Oh yeah, well, that's where growth hormone is released when we're sleeping, and that's when all your nutrients go to work and start recovering. So that's, you know, where the magic happens is when we're sleeping. And if we're not getting quality sleep, then that growth hormone is not getting released and the recovery is not happening as efficiently. So yes, it's a huge piece of the puzzle too. And then there's hydration to add on to all the things that you just mentioned. So if we're not maximizing our hydration as athletes, we're not creating an environment where nutrients can get to where they need to go. For cell turnover, for lean muscle mass production, for brain cell development and helping your mental clarity, just like we were talking about too. So that's a piece of nutrition too that I think a lot of athletes are missing. You know, we're drinking water, but are we regulating our electrolytes? Are we consuming enough electrolytes in our foods? Are we taking electrolyte supplements if we need it based on our sweat needs? So there's all these different layers of nutrition. And some athletes are nailing their hydration, but they're not getting enough protein. Some, you know, athletes are really doing well on the carbohydrate and they're timing their carbohydrate properly as it pertains to their training and their racing, but they're not hydrated, you know? So there's different checks and balances to go through also.
So what, one of the things when we wrote Cool Coach, I had really smart people around me, so I'm not taking credit for all of this, but Dr. Rick Sharp had done a study that everyone ignored and it really bothered him because it was a really cool study. It was based upon stress. And what he basically did was knew that based upon velocity as compared to your best, there were certain amounts of stress. And things that surprised us when we wrote the algorithm with him was, here's what's funny. We went 10 25s on 130. I'm going to remember this somewhat right. 10 25s on 130, all out. Then we did 10 25 once we wrote the algorithm. So then we did 10 100s on 130. And it was all out too. 10 100s on 130, but the person had a 120, let's just say.
Okay.
Okay, so then we knew as compared to the 120, how fast they were going. They were going as fast as they could, 10 100s, 1,000 yards, fast as you could on 130, 10 25s on 130, all out, which was more stressful. Unbelievably, and not exponentially, but a lot, the 10 25s were harder.
Really?
There wasn't enough rest in the 130 to really cause enough stress because there just wasn't, they couldn't go fast enough. After the first one, if they were making 130, they were aerobic. No matter what we tried to do, they were aerobic because they were just, the rest was too small. So they couldn't really get those muscles to work. Whereas in the 25s, they all worked. So this is back to the USRPT thing. They have a point, they do.
Yes.
But here's the thing. If we take that to nutrition now.
Yeah.
How much stress was there? Was there, do we need to bump the calories because the 1025s were more stressful, or do we need to bump the protein and the creatine or whatever else so that they can continue to do that? Or is it actually affecting what the Dave Salos, Dr. Dave Salos and others have said, this is actually giving you an aerobic response, even though you're going fast. Now, whether they're right or wrong, nutrition-wise, yeah. Do you need the same thing for that person going that fat? Now, you still have to have the velocity, because if you go 1025s, averaging 120, I'm 130, you don't need any nutrition. You probably, you know, can eat a banana on the first of the day and have enough for the whole day. So that's where it comes down to what we've already done for our homework to give you some CGI clues.
Yeah.
Because we know the stress based upon how much of each energy system they're doing. And Ron actually programs this into his training, as many good coaches do.
Yep.
And so then he can also say, well, yeah, but that's what we programmed into our training, but that's what they, this is where they failed. This is where they couldn't do what I wanted them to do.
Yeah.
Is there a clue in terms of the combination of I think you're basically saying we can have all the nutrition we want, but if we don't get enough sleep, that is my problem. So, but sleep's easy to get as long as they're honest. Now, this all, a lot of this comes down to, is the athlete motivated to be honest as opposed to motivated to impress us? I say that a lot in terms of stroke, is don't dolphin kick underwater to impress me, because you saw it in a video and everybody dolphin kicks underwater. Don't do eight because so-and-so did eight. If you're going slower than you can swim.
Right. How fast
can you, I can go into most teams in the United States. I can tell you, most teams in the United States, and ask anyone, what's your best 25-yard dolphin kick? And they don't know.
Really?
And yet it's 65% of the 100 if you're going to win.
Right. Wow.
5%. So then we'll go to your side. What percentage of, or maybe I should start asking more. Now, let's do that, because we've laid the foundation. What percentage of elite performance is nutrition, would you say?
I think you asked me this last time. It's so hard to tell. Because like you said, elite performance is a lot different because they're just genetically gifted. So I've had plenty of athletes come to me with really suboptimal diets, and they're still performing really well. Now, is that youth? Is that just natural talent? Is, we don't know. But I can tell you that if you improve your diet, your performance will improve no matter what. So even if you're great, you're going to be more great. Even if you're so-so, you're going to get better. You know, just, it's just kind of linear. In general, I mean, this is so non-scientific, but I really think it's like 80%. It's a lot. It's, holy, and it's, yeah. It's just for the reason that we cannot, the same thing as the Indy 500 cars. You cannot go anywhere unless you have the fuel. You can't get in a car and expect to drive to California with no gas in your tank. So you don't have, think about this. Food is measured in calories. Calories is a measurement of energy. So if you're not getting the proper amount of food, first of all, just talking amount, not the quality of food, amount of food, you're not going to be able to produce any kind of energy. And what you're doing in the pool is you're expending energy.
Right.
And that comes back to food. So if you're having cookies and pizza and beer, you're gonna have energy. It's energy for sure. And it's gonna get you so far. But if you're having, you know, grilled chicken and vegetables and whole grain rice or brown rice, I should say, and so you're getting all your nutrients with maybe avocado for your good fat or just a really well-balanced meal, you're going to actually go much farther because your body can utilize all of those nutrients more than the cookies and the pizza and the beer.
So somebody comes in September
mm-hmm.
for us to coach professionally.
Yep.
No, we're professionals, right? That's one thing I have to knock on. We had somebody come in here for a lesson a couple of weeks ago and said that their coach was actually sunbathing on the deck while their kid was swimming. I said, get another coach. I mean, it's pretty easy. But then somebody comes in and the coach is like, yeah, let's try this year. I don't mean that kind of coach, but you know, we're trying to provide leadership for these kids.
Yeah.
So we have a plan. And if you don't have a plan and you're watching this, you know, get a plan. We'll help you get a plan. I'll help you get a plan. Just competitiveswimmer.com. It won't be my plan, but I think it has to be somewhat of a plan. You have to say, okay, we're going to do stroke work on Monday. We're going to go right into freestyle and we're going to count your strokes. So we start the process of you never leave a wall without a goal. That's my big saying I give them every time I go to a workshop. And for coaches or for swimmers, I say, if you're a recreational swimmer and you're just bouncing around, it's kind of your point about nutrition. You're just bouncing around the pool for 8 hours every summer. You're bouncing around. You'll get a little faster, but you won't get fast, you know? Right. And if you go to Dr. Genetogist and he says, the world record should be 43 in the 100 meters. So when you say they're successful, I'm kind of going, yeah, but I lived at a time when Mark Spitz was the fastest thing that ever swam and no one would ever go faster. And now high school girls can beat him. So, yeah. You know, I think we're there. I think we're still there. And Dr. Mm-hmm. G thinks that, and he works with some of the best teams in the world. You see him, you know, working with Phelps when he's got the 8 gold medals and taking lactate samples. You should have been there taking nutrition samples, whatever, or blood samples, yeah. But maybe that's the next step.
Right.
So let's say you walk in September, you have to give them some general thing as part of your CGI. And you give everyone pretty much in a group that's going to go, say, 20,000 meters that week, the same nutritional guidance. Mm-hmm. This is about how many calories you should take in. And here's what I want you to do. I want you to keep those numbers for me in this little Excel interactive spreadsheet you and I can devise. Mm-hmm. Right now, if we want to, but by the next time everybody sees us, right?
Yeah.
We give a little thing and we say, okay, so you fill this out for us and you do that for the first couple of weeks. Maybe there's a psychological thing. You say, how did you feel? Coming into practice, coming out of practice? How did you sleep? Was it easy to go to sleep? Right. What are your other stresses? Because maybe that affects how we're going to tell them to eat and that kind of thing.
Sure.
Yeah. Male or female, maybe a couple little things, right, that we do in the algorithm. But then we also say, okay, you were supposed to go 20,000 or 20,000. Did you miss a practice? I mean, is there anything in there that throws us off? Right. But in general, you and I could maybe with CGI and go, okay, we've got 20 athletes and 15 of them are doing great. What's the anomaly in the five? Or 15 are doing pretty average. What's the anomaly in the five that are doing so much better in terms of their nutrition, maybe only with given that all the other science is sort of, you know, locked in.
Yeah.
Not easy, but with a large enough end, don't you think we'd be able to start to get some real habit?
I definitely think so. Yeah, I definitely do. Cause that's how you can see patterns and that's how you can make connections between nutrition and performance.
So I think I can convince some coaches to do this if you want to help me write this up.
Yeah, I would love that. And then what you can do is say that's the first 2 months, did you say, of the season, of the training periodization season. And then when we get into the build phase, maybe we can just increase those calories 10 to 20% or whatever we figure out that we need to, and then do the same, gain the same feedback from those swimmers and say, okay, did you feel any better? Did you go any faster? Did you sleep any better? All those variables and find the feedback from there. Same thing with taper, same thing with racing. That would be really interesting.
Yeah, I think by taper, you'd probably have some real clues as to what to tell this person to eat. You know,
I think
you'd have some real hints for the coach, for the team, for the parents. Now I work one